kind thanks to Irfan for pulling it off, and great congratulations to the whole community here informing the center, which is close to my heart, of course. We just passed the 10th anniversary of the Joint Quantum Institute, a joint entity shared by the University of Maryland and NIST in College Park, Maryland, and many of the same goals, of course, are shared. And it's not a quantum computing institute, it's a quantum science institute. Even though I'm a strong proponent that that these will be tied together for a long time, even if something happens and the floor falls out of quantum computing, quantum science will still be here. And having a lively science institute like the one here in Berkeley and several others throughout the world that have started in the last few years is incredibly exciting. But in the spirit of maybe our last panel session, I guess I could think that the gloves are off and now it's time to hit back. But I actually have a different view of this, and I think that many of you know the atomic physics community and the trapped ion community to perhaps be a little stodgy. We do precision metrology, like to measure the 9th, 10th, and 11th digit of something, just because. And I think the superconducting community in this field, again, started when I was an undergraduate and the work of John Clark and others, other pioneers in the field, Hans Muy out in Delft, and the way it's continued at Yale and other places, it's given us a swift kick in the ass, actually, and it's welcome. And I think the take-home message will be that this field is so young that people mentioned there will be hybrid systems. I think the applications will be, depending on the application, you might want a different hardware, and that's probably going to continue for a few decades. So I don't think it's a zero-sum game. If one of these technologies wins, I think they both win. Okay, so Irfan instructed me, this is a public lecture, but I think I recognize pretty much most of the faces that have been here all day. On the other hand, I'll apologize if you're bored in the first 20 minutes or so as I introduce things. I'll try to go through that quickly. I was also told the crowd is not necessarily Hamiltonian friendly. I actually think you guys are, but there will be no Hamiltonians here. Or I'll try to talk about them through the back door. So quantum information science, if many of us have taught quantum mechanics to undergraduates, the last time I taught it, I actually flip things around. Many of my friends have done the same, where you introduce the concepts of quantum mechanics from an information theory point of view, so bits to qubits and so forth. And then I find it connects much better with young people. And one nice thing there is not that I'm an expert in computer science or the history of 20th century classical computing. These history books have been written, and they're fun to read. And I'm not one to think that history will be repeated exactly, but we can make many analogies to what happened 50, 60, 70 years ago. And well, what happened, at least in the US, was that this ENIAC computer made the light of day in the late 40s, somewhat behind the Brits and their Colossus machine. But the point is, it was made of vacuum tubes, which was a pretty unreliable type of memory. And this came on the heels of remarkable work by Claude Shannon and Alan Turing, who codified information theory and the abstract theory of computing. And I think the message there was, computing doesn't depend on the hardware that runs it. You can make a computer out of any hardware. It was said earlier that computing is physical. That's certainly true. And I think this opened up the world to going from a vacuum tube system to a solid-state transistor-based system. And once Shannon defined the bit as the fundamental unit of information, we scientists and engineers began looking for bits in nature. And this ended up being one of the most reliable, of course, based on semiconductor action. We all love this picture because it's a physics picture. And we all love it because we know what happened from that type of a physics into this Moore's law, which really, when you think about it, I know it's a cliche, it's just unbelievable. There's nothing else in the history of humanity that has such a power law like this. Doubling in, however you want to measure it, density, performance every year or two for many decades. And so this is obviously the Intel processors throughout the last several decades. And now we're hitting over 10 billion, I guess, transistors on a given size chip. So I guess earlier there was a fun discussion on is this a crisis? Because we know that if we follow this power law over the next few decades, that this Moore's law will end. Well, you have to say what you mean by that. I would say that it's not controversial to claim that Moore's law will end dealing with silicon classical computers, okay? Because for the simple reason, they're just going to get too small. And I actually have I have heuristic proof of that. This laptop I just bought last year, it's worse than the one I bought 3 or 4 years ago, and that's the first time that's ever happened. for what it's worth, it's a PC. in any case, so this Moore's law. I think as a physicist, we're inspired by almost everything Richard Feynman did, even in this field, even if it was attributed to him later, just because he's a colorful character. But it is a fact that in 1959, he gave this talk, this famous talk at American Physical Society meeting. There's plenty of room at the bottom. And he was intrigued by this thing, the fact that you could make circuits out of solid state. And it didn't have to be big. It could be shrunk down to very small dimensions. And he even said, muses, if you make circuits out of a few atoms, there are completely new opportunities for design. So he didn't know what quantum computing was. He didn't know what that opportunity was. But I think in the last few decades, we could argue credibly that that opportunity is quantum computing. When you get down to the level of individual atoms, systems that have very few degrees of freedom, quantum mechanics, those are the new laws of physics that underlie them. So in that spirit, what is quantum information science? As I mentioned, we can use analogies to classical computing. The bits become qubits, quantum bits, and in this case, it doesn't, in the spirit of Turing and Shannon, it doesn't matter what it is, as long as it's a quantum two-level system. In this case, I've chosen a poor description of an atom to represent two levels, two electronic orbits that could store the state 0 and 1. And because it's quantum, we can store a continuous superposition of any weighting whatsoever between 0 and 1. And the information, in a sense, is encoded in these continuous variables, alpha and beta, 90-10 or 50-50 or whatever. And so the wave theory of quantum mechanics says that this alpha and beta follows a wave equation. It undulates. It can be complicated. There's a lot of math behind it. There's not a lot of understanding behind it. Once you're given the wave equation, just like the waves on a rope or on the surface of water, you can use it to calculate. But the really interesting thing is that what does it mean to have a superposition? And this has pushed quantum mechanics into the realm of philosophy and all kinds of other non-scientific discussions, which actually make it very interesting to talk about. And this has to do with taking this idea of a superposition and reconciling it with our classical laws of physics, where we don't have superpositions. You can't prepare this thing in two places at the same time. It has too many degrees of freedom. It's too big. Well, what does it mean? Somebody's going to look at it, and they're included in the system. So the way we tie this up in conventional quantum mechanics is to say, well, superpositions are fine, but when we make a measurement, when we look at the system collapses. I put quotes around that because I shouldn't put quotes around that. I'm comfortable using that terminology, and most of the scientific world is. The state collapses into one or the other. The and becomes an or, and therefore it makes sense. Now we can measure definite states. And the fundamental interesting question here is that this measurement process and this wave equation process, they don't seem to be related. They seem to be two totally different tenets of quantum mechanics. Many have tried to relate them, but they often bring up other issues that are even more complicated. So we have in physics, we hate it when we don't have a system of laws that start from one and everything comes down. So quantum mechanics makes everybody uncomfortable. It becomes emotional. People throw stones and so forth. Fortunately, I can duck into the lab and not worry about that. I subscribe to this view. This works for me. Now, the point that you might want to have to define a measurement. Does it mean there's a conscious being that wrote something down? And in fact, no, it doesn't. You can generalize measurement simply to mean that your system interacted with something outside of its realm. It wasn't isolated. So this wave equation nature of quantum mechanics is only valid in isolation, and that's what we usually teach in quantum mechanics. It works for an isolated system. A measurement, an observer with a consciousness, of course, is the epitome of interacting with the outside world, including a conscious brain and so forth. But even if your system has an air molecule that's going to slam into it, and if you have a superposition of position, that air molecule is part of the system now, and the air could hit this wall or that wall. The walls are part of the system. So you can see that you can generalize the concept of a measurement to not involve people, which is good. Okay, so there's what we have. And I think Steve Girvan this morning gave a very nice pedagogical description of this issue, quantum measurement, the fact that the information, where is it? Is it the fact that we have discrete zeros and ones or continuous variables alpha and beta? By the way, one other thing is that when you do measure these two, I forgot to mention, the probability of getting the zero or one is related in a very specific way to these amplitudes. So if you have a 90-10 superposition, you're going to get 90% of the time one of these states and 10% the other. So another way to couch the weirdness of quantum mechanics is that probabilities are at the top level of this theory. And this is unlike any other branch of mathematics, I'd say more science, anything. Probabilities are useful in everything from economics to biology to physics, but they're only used because we have ignorance. Like tossing a coin, we have ignorance on the exact rotational velocity of the coin and so forth. In quantum mechanics, it's not based on ignorance, it's based on quantum mechanics, it's there. And so probabilities, if you think deeply, I maybe would caution you not to think too deeply about probabilities, they're strange. Where do they come from? Well, they're there, so we live with it. So it's a probabilistic theory by default. Now, I'm going to talk about what happens when you throw a bunch of these qubits together, there seems to be another physical action that happens that's very interesting. It's called entanglement. When you have more than one qubit, this is the simplest type of entanglement, two qubits, for instance, quantum mechanics allows you to write this state of two qubits. I have a superposition of 0, 0, there's the two qubits, but that is superposed with the state 1, 1, with some weighting, alpha and beta. Now, this is strange because, remember, when you measure this superposition, you will project the system into one state or the other. In either case, the two qubits will have exactly the same answer. They will be perfectly correlated. Yet, nobody required that these two qubits be near each other. So they could be on opposite sides of the galaxy and still have perfect correlations. They could report perfect correlations faster than light could traverse the distance. Doesn't mean anything. We're violating anything here. But correlations can persist in ways that were thought impossible. Quantum mechanics is also a non-local theory. This is what we learn. And I draw this picture here. The only analogy of quantum entanglement I know of, and it comes from an optical illusion. So when you draw a cube, an ambiguous cube, on a blackboard with no perspective, so all the lines are parallel, there's an ambiguous perspective of this front face. Is it the red one or is it the blue one? With the orientation of that cube. And when you put multiple cubes together, you'll see that they end up popping into the same perspective. Now, if you look at this, stare at it for a while, you can sort of see it pops into the red and then the blue and the red and the blue, but usually lock into one. You can also trick it. If you really work hard, you can see one and the other, but it's only an analogy. It's a really good one, and it involves an optical illusion. I wish there were more, and I put this up here because it's due to a fellow Fred Allen Wolf, who was mentioned this morning as one of the hippies. He was an LBL staffer. I guess hippies in quantum mechanics has to be Berkeley, right? Yes, okay. So Fred Allen Wolf has a wonderful book, Taking the Quantum Leap, and this is his analogy to entanglement. It's really nice. I also think, I was just talking to Brigida, I'm pretty sure there's an analogy to entanglement involving tones of music, involving consonants and dissonance, but I haven't figured that out. That's going to be a little harder, but I think that's possible. So again, a superposition, when measured, we'll see one or the other. And in a sense, entanglement, Entanglement involves correlations, but there doesn't have to be any physical interaction when the measurement happens. Of course, there probably was a physical interaction. In fact, there probably has to be to start the entanglement, but they can be separated and then measured. And again, to this audience, I hesitate to say this, but the power of quantum computing is in these hidden wirings, wirings given by entanglement. Okay, so entanglement, very important topic here. And it's not new, though. It was first brought out of the woodwork in the 30s in the context of Einstein and his colleagues trying to show that quantum mechanics is just silly. They came up with effectively states that are entangled like this, and again, showing that if they're separated, then somehow there's this non-locality. If you measure one, the other one gets immediately known, and it seems to be information traveling faster than light. Now, 1935 was before Shannon's information theory treatise in the early 50s from Bell Labs, and it turns out that the only thing you can do with a bunch of copies of this pairwise entangled state is send random numbers. So if I send you random numbers, it turns out that the information content is zero. And so in a way, that sews up the so-called EPR paradox, Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen. But this title, it's like all his papers, they're wonderful to read, even for beginning students. And this title is just wonderful. I mean, he's questioning quantum mechanics because of this, the feature of entanglement. It's just too weird. Now, John Bell's name was brought up earlier. It's a shame that Einstein didn't live to meet Bell and learn of his results on showing that I'm distilling his mathematical arguments, which are really beautiful in their purity, but his results basically show in certain proposed experiments that if you do complete quantum mechanics, you're going to introduce something that's at least as weird as we already have, probably worse. So, according to Einstein's own principle of Occam's razor, might as well keep the old quantum mechanics, I guess. I'm not sure what Einstein would think now. But I think his heart was in the right place. This is just weird stuff. And I should also mention, and I'll try to do this throughout, it's very easy, there's a great Berkeley connection to measuring Bell's inequalities. The first measurements were done at LBL by John Clauser and Stuart Friedman back in 1972 involving cascaded atom spontaneous decays and correlations of them. Okay, so another few minutes. Now we're going to put qubits together, and following up on Steve's theme of having good news and bad news. When I was a kid, I subscribed to Mad Magazine. They used to have these good news, bad news, good news things. They're very funny. Quantum computing, maybe it's not as funny, but there is a good news, bad news, and then a final piece of good news. And the first piece of good news is sort of evident that when you put lots of qubits together, things get really big. The space grows exponentially with the number of qubits. There are 2 to the n binary numbers of n bits. So with 3, there are 8. With 300, there are 10 to the 90 or something. So in a sense, even with 300 qubits, there's more stuff there than we have the number of particles in the universe. Now, hold off on the bad news. We all know bad news is here. We can't necessarily get access to that information. But the idea of parallel computing, sending all these inputs into a black box all at once, turning the crank, and getting all these answers at once seems kind of cool. We're doing parallel processing in a massive scale. And of course, the bad news is that when we make this measurement, not only are our single bits random 0 or 1, we have a random output based on 2 to the n inputs. So in fact, by measuring this in general, it's worse than a classical computer because we don't even know which input corresponded to what we measured. And so you'd probably have to invert this function to find out what the input was. And at that stage, why not just do this in series on a classical computer, one then the other? Okay. So an obvious piece of bad news, and I think Steve said it better than I could ever, that there's this funny issue of being able to process all this information, but getting access to it's another story. The final piece of good news, of course, and Steve said this as well, is that we have a wave equation. Before measurement, there's linear unitary evolution between these qubits. They interfere. They can interfere constructively, destructively, and there are some algorithms, some ways to get the interference to go just so, and the outputs all end up vanishing, and we end up with a 100% probability of one qubit and zero on the others, or something that is not as doesn't have as much entropy as this, anyway. So maybe there are a few answers at the end, a small number, and by repeating the experiment over and over again, you can sample from that distribution. And in these cases, you end up getting an answer that could depend on all the inputs, so many inputs that you could never deal with them classically. So that's the final piece of good news. And I've cleverly been very vague on exactly what these red dots are, they're quantum gates, and how they're arranged. Well, there aren't that many algorithms that can be cast in this form. And this is obviously a major avenue of research now in quantum computer science to do that. It's not clear what classes of problems are amenable to quantum computing. But again, I'll duck into the lab and say I'm very interested in these gates anyway, and trying to build a machine that can control such interference. And here again, we can make analogies to classical computers, classical gate structures. Now, classically, we have the NOT gate on a single bit. Quantum mechanically, we have something you might call the square root of NOT gate, which it basically makes superpositions. It takes a state 0 and produces that superposition, takes the state 1 and makes that superposition. Now, this is a little bit jargon if you haven't had a course in quantum mechanics, I should have spelled out this notation means that's a quantum state. It's an abstract vector, but it describes a quantum state as the position of electron in an atom, or the position of something, or the current in a superconductor. It doesn't really matter. And the plus sign means that we have a superposition. This is a plus sign with a minus sign. And the reason you need that is that quantum mechanics, the wave equation is reversible. And by doing this, if you do this, by putting the minus sign in there, we get two different outputs that are orthogonal, depending on two different inputs. If we had a plus sign here, then we'd have the same output for two distinct inputs, and that's not reversible. Okay? So the minus sign, and in general, having a phase in front of these allows quantum mechanics to be reversible. So in quantum circuit lingo, the cartoons look like this. We have an input state, and we're going to rotate it. This is sometimes called a pi over 2 rotation. Again, that's jargon. It comes from NMR language. But in general, we can rotate a qubit about any axis we want through any angle we choose. And that's sort of a generic single qubit gate that we might want to do. More interesting, I suppose, are the multi-qubit gates, because these give rise to entanglement. And this is, again, an analogy to the classical exclusive OR. This is sometimes called a control NOT gate, where you flip the second bit depending on the state of the first bit. So if the first bit is high, then you flip the second bit. And you'll see that a simple version of an entangler here is to make the first bit a superposition of 0 and 1, and initialize the second bit in the state 0. So you're in a superposition of lines 1 and 3 here. You end up with 0, 0 plus 1, 1, therefore entangled. So it's a controlled way to make entanglements. And these red dots are supposed to be gates that push the interference in the way that you want. Now, I'm going to be a little bit on thin ice for the next few slides. You might ask, what are these things good for? And again, it's not my expertise. I can only report what I read. And I would say the conventional killer applications in quantum computing, most of us know this, are number factoring and searching unsorted databases, both coming about 20 years ago. And the factoring algorithm is incredibly important, sort of in the same vein that showing quantum supremacy is important. It's an existence proof that there is something out there that is exponentially better than any known classical algorithm. Now, it may be that a good classical algorithm comes along, classically that is able to do factoring better. Maybe it exists already. Maybe it's all a ruse. No, anyway. I would hope not. Anyway, we'll see about that. Well, you know, if that is the case, well, at least we have our quantum science. That's still there. So that Shor's algorithm, Grover's algorithm, it's only a quadratic speed up, a little less interesting. One that is near to the hearts of most physicists and chemists interested in this field is the idea of quantum simulation, where you take, this is talked about quite a bit all day today, where you take a hard quantum problem in physics or chemistry, and you map it onto a very controlled quantum system. Wolfgang Ketterle talked quite a bit about this in the context of neutral atoms. Analogies of superfluidity and supersolidity, things that are very difficult to calculate. So you simulate it on a very controlled system, in Wolfgang's case, optical lattices and neutral atoms. Again, any platform that's good for quantum computing will be good for quantum simulation. Now, in terms of the applications, again, these are some of them are a little out there. One that has a lot of resonance right now, I think especially here at Berkeley, is simulating chemistry, simulating electronic interactions. Even in a simple molecule that might only have 20 electrons overall, that's still 20 interacting fermions, very difficult problem, all those orbitals. This is a light harvesting molecule. There's a fixation, a nitrogen fixation recently, understanding how to break nitrogen bonds to form ammonia for fertilizer, basically. So this is, I would say, an application space. I'm gonna revisit this a little bit more in the context of studying quantum magnetism in trapped ions. And then finally, this again, I probably know the least about, but you can sort of wave your hands around and say, well, if quantum systems can sample exponentially large spaces, then maybe they can deal with very complex functions that have a global minimum that's intractable. Here's a graph of a function of just two variables, but you could imagine having lots of variables and trying to test all the inputs, all the possibilities to find the global minimum. That can be a very hard problem. Problems like that are ubiquitous in everything from pattern recognition to machine learning and so forth. And I think there's lots of hints that quantum systems could be good at this. Even approximating the true ground state might be cost effective, right? You don't need to have the perfect ground state. And again, I won't comment more on this, except to know that this is a classical function here. Finding the values of this vector x to minimize this function is really hard. It looks a little like a transverse Ising model in quantum mechanics, doesn't it? And so there could be a connection between those two type systems. So I want to dive in and start to talk about hardware overall. And we've seen some pictures like this today. I've added a little more detail to it, and these axes don't really have numbers to them, but I guess number of particles do, the number of qubits, and here the sort of the controllability. And in general, I suppose there's a law that if you have lots of particles, you probably don't have so much control per particle, if you have a constant budget, maybe. So those that have very few particles, like ions and superconductors, which it's just no surprise, those are the ones that are now operating gates at very high fidelities, and I would say are ready to be built up. They come with very few particles, and the question is, we really want to be always up and to the right, like in any plot. On the other hand, we have systems that are more neutral atoms in clouds. There's very little control per particle, but even that's changing. We saw some data from Harvard and Munich this morning on controlling individual atoms, and lots of other things in between. Very interesting candidates from gated silicon quantum dots to NV vacancies, and Dime and David Elshalom talked about other defects in solid state that look really interesting. But I would say these two, trapped ions and superconductors, they're sticking out right now. I think you've heard a lot about these and from the experts, and I will only highlight, I'll talk a little more about ions now, but sort of highlighting the differences. And these differences are good because I think they're complementary in their challenges. They will be complementary in their application space. I'm convinced of that. So now, atomic ions, they are atomic clocks. The qubits are atomic clocks. We're done with the qubit. We're not going to improve the qubit ever. They're the best qubit you can have. They can be replicated to be identical to a part in 10 to the 15 if you really need. We never need that good of performance. The qubit states can be very long-lived. They can be 1,000 seconds if you really want, probably longer. We don't really need that yet, although I like Girvan's law that I think we have a long runway in trapped ions for Girvan's law.
Can you confirm that I didn't ask you to talk about superconducting qubits?
Say it again?
Can you confirm that I didn't ask you to talk about superconducting qubits?
No. No. So, no, of course. Irfan is a little disclaimer. He did not ask me to talk about superconductors. But again, I don't think it's a zero-sum game between these two technologies. I think it's wonderful that they're both being developed, and we both will learn from each other, both communities. Now, the difference is where they're, I'm going to highlight these more in a moment. Obviously, the great advantage of superconductors is that they're material 2D chips that can be printed out. The materials processing, sort of leveraging Moore's law in silicon, can be adapted to many of these structures. They're fast. The clock speed of superconducting gates are about 1,000 times faster than ion gates. I'll tell you why that is in a minute. I do put a little asterisk here because the gate speed in this game, if you look at one number, it never includes the entire story. Be that gate fidelity, qubit number, gate speed. Time to completion of an algorithm depends on more than just the clock speed. It depends on how the system is connected and so forth, and I'll return to that later. But in general, the superconducting systems will be a lot faster. Again, on the upside for atoms, they're all identical, and importantly, the wiring is not wired. it's installed from the outside, so it's reconfigurable. It's sort of like an FPGA. You can reconfigure it to model any quantum graph you want, any gates that you want. And as is typical in solid state, you usually have a static circuit that's hardwired. It may be that the turnaround time is very fast, but if you're looking for an algorithm, if you're trying to implement an algorithm, you're probably going to wire your qubits to take advantage of the implicit architecture of that algorithm. And if you want people to use your system and maybe have them come up with their own algorithm, you might want that flexibility of having them being able to wire it the way they want. Okay. So one big challenge here, and I think this might address some of the questions at the panel, why aren't companies getting into trapped ions? Well, they kind of are, and I'll talk about that in a minute, but this is a system that involves UHV vacuum chambers, lasers. It involves high power RF. These are all weird things for computing. And it makes sense that the behemoths are investing in technology they know and love. And I think some of the people on the panel will be working with trapped ions in a few years. That's just a bold prediction. But there are investments in both camps. These are sort of non-academic investments by government agencies and also companies in these two technologies. There are investments in trapped ions from industry, including those at Lockheed. I would say more interestingly, Honeywell is gearing up to have a big system here, and they have some presence in atomic physics. They make sensors, they make atomic clocks, and they also do wonderful fabrication of ion trap chips. Actually, this one here is actually from Sandia. I'll talk about that in a moment. Let me dive into trapped ions for a little bit since we haven't heard anything about them too much yet. The one thing I like about this picture most, I suppose, is this list, because when I started in this field working with Dave Wineland for about 10 years in the 90s, we were the only group in the world that could play around with atoms, ions, and entangle them. We were making better clocks. We were entangling simply to reduce noise in clocks. It seems esoteric, but we were making quantum gates at the time, and so this is why when Shor's algorithm came out, it just fell right into our laps. We just had to rename what we were already doing. There's 50 or 60 groups around the world, including Hartmut Hefner here at Berkeley, who are thoroughly invested in ion traps for quantum control, quantum information science, and related activities. So even though it's sort of a crusty old atomic physics technology, it's more exciting now than it ever has been. A lot of young people in the field. Here you can see an old vacuum chamber with an older trap of ours, but even that has changed for the better, and I would say this is largely due to the group at Sandia National Labs. We'll hear from Peter Mounds on Wednesday to talk about, this is a chip of silicon, it's about a centimeter on a side, and there are about 48 electrodes in here, and ions hover above the surface, and they're making traps finally at Sandia and Honeywell that are much better than anything I could make in the lab. I'm so glad about that because I hate making these because they, anyway, ask Dave Wineland about this. He'll say, you make two ion traps of the same kind and they're gonna be different. So the standard ion trap is coming. Okay, let me talk about qubits within atoms. Again, they're atomic clocks. And so pick your atom, or as we like to say sometimes, pick your poison. None of them are perfect. They all have better or worse features. The one I'm going to talk about, it kind of hardly matters. There are certain features of an atom that make it good, but one thing is for sure, you need to have two levels in the atom that are very stable and have long coherence times. We choose hyperfine ground states of atoms, and ytterbium-171+ is hydrogenic. It has one outer electron, so the electronics is very simple. It also has a spin 1/2 nucleus, just like hydrogen. Even though it's in ytterbium, it's a very heavy nucleus. So the quantum numbers are the same as you have in hydrogen. So I tell students in the lab, pay attention to hydrogen. Nobody else will use it, but you actually will use it here in this laboratory. Unlike hydrogen, the hyperfine splitting is not 1 gigahertz, it's about 12.6 gigahertz. And importantly, these two states are not sensitive to magnetic fields to lowest order. So it's a good qubit, and if you make an atomic clock, you have to use states like this. And we use those for our qubit. So without any shielding or any special work, we can realize a few seconds of coherence time. Of course, the T1 time, the lifetime of even the excited state here is it's infinite or so. I mean, this is a microwave transition. It can only decay via magnetic dipole radiation. So a very good qubit. And we can detect this qubit by shining laser light on an appropriate transition that it scatters lots of photons. It's a cycling transition. And the important point is, in one state, it glows. In the other state, it's dark. Because in the other state, that same laser is now 12 gigahertz away from an excited state that only has 20 megahertz of line width. So it's pretty much dark. And so in a single shot, bright or dark, we get a binary measurement. Now, one little piece of background, I won't get into too much detail. And it's not because I'm sweeping it under the rug. Yes, we have lasers. This laser at 355 nanometers drives what we call a coherent transition. This is what makes gates. It makes the square root of NOT gate. It makes a controlled NOT gate. This laser, it's a pulse laser, so it has a frequency comb, and we take two components of that comb and make sure that those two teeth are near this hyperfine splitting, and that's actually easy to do. It comes out of the factory that way. But all of the beams are very, very far away from any direct resonance. They're detuned by 33 terahertz, and their bandwidth is only 100 gigahertz. So that's a lot of hertz numbers for you, but the point is there's no spontaneous scattering. We're not measuring here. We're doing coherent operations. And we can use these lasers to apply forces and make entangled states, and I want to give you a one or two minute view of how you entangle trapped ions, and it's going to involve their motion. So here we have a collection of trapped ions, and I showed the picture back here. I wanted to explain this a little more. This is an image of about 15 ytterbium ions that are trapped in this little volume in the middle there, and they're imaged by this microscope. They're separated by a few microns. They can stay there for a long time, hours. So it's sort of like a very simple atomically perfect solid. And we can image them because we're shining laser light that's tuned to resonance, very narrow resonance, and we collect their fluorescence. When we turn the light off, the ions are still there, they're just dark, and they don't collide with a surface, they're not part of a solid, and hopefully your vacuum is good enough so that they don't collide with the background. Every hour or so that happens. Okay. So having a sample of ions like this, within each ion there's a qubit, and we would like to entangle them, we'd like to do gates. Well, here's how you do it. You shine a laser beam on the two ions that you would like to entangle. Now, this laser beam is specially tuned that it gives a force. I won't go into the details here, but there are several ways to do this. The force depends on the state of the qubit. So for simplicity, if the qubit is spin up, it moves up. If it's spin down, it moves down. So it's easier to remember. Now, the important thing is there are four possibilities of these two qubits. If they're both up, they both move up together. If they're both down, they move down together. And only their Coulomb energy is the same. It's not changed. But if one is down, the other's up, or the other way around, they're a little further apart. And you can calculate the difference, the defect in energy, it's just the difference between these two Coulomb energies, and you find that it is an effective dipole-dipole interaction. It falls off like 1/r³. And this dipole moment can be huge because we've sort of taken a charge, an atomic ion, and moved it in two places. That's a dipole, and it has a big dipole moment. These can be very strong interactions. Now, you might ask about what happened to all the other ions. Well, if you do this really fast, if this laser pulse has a lot of power, then none of the other ions are involved at all. There's no time for sound waves to propagate through the chain, if you want to think of it that way. The phonon modes, the vibrations, are at about 1 megahertz. They're kind of slow. And if we can do this at a gigahertz, you're fine. But in practice, we don't do it at a gigahertz, and we have to deal with all that motion. And so I kind of am sweeping it under the rug right now, but we sort of know how to do that. Okay, so for these two ions, let's look at the truth table. We have four possibilities, and two possibilities suffer a phase shift because their energy changed. And importantly, that phase shift is the same and the same sign. That makes it nonlinear. Why is it nonlinear? Well, what happened to up, up is not the product of what happened to down, up, and up, down. And that's what makes this formally equivalent to a controlled NOT gate when this phase is set to pi over 2. Now, in practice, I meant to acknowledge Serac and Zoller, who this was not the model they pointed out, but the basic physics behind this is really due to Ignacio Serac and Peter Zoller. Between Shor's algorithm, between Dave Wineland and I demonstrating the gate was Serac and Zoller showing you should demonstrate that gate. It involved this type of interaction, applying a force to these ions to get them entangled. Now, in fact, the gate we use now is much better than their model. There are all kinds of details I won't get into. Now it's called the Molmer and Sorensen interaction. But it's basically an icing gate. It applies an icing type magnetic interaction between these two for a certain amount of time. And that's what we used. Okay, here's answer B to why there aren't so many industrial concerns in trapped ions. So this is you might see this as a typical AMO lab, and it's unfortunate that it's like this. Most AMO people are proud of this. I'm embarrassed by this. We have to move beyond this, that's certainly for sure. And the controls of the lasers are pretty much taking all this real estate. But I am happy to say that very recently, in the last couple of years, we have been able to, believe it or not, abstract away the hardware and realize algorithms. And we're now calling this sort of a stack of what we do to realize a bunch of gates. Now, I have spent most of my career down here dealing with individual ions and shining lasers on them. But once we calibrate the system, it is stable for many, many hours. And we can actually reach upward and have compilers and software. At the very high level, you look in a textbook and decide what algorithm you want to perform. And we need to reduce the textbook gates into the gates that we have. That's a translation step, and maybe there's compression going on. And then we have to take these gates that we have physically, our native gates, and transform them into laser pulses. And the laser pulses then, this is where the quantum physics comes down to the bottom. So having this software stack, top to bottom, is, to me, what makes a computer is that the user doesn't have to know what's inside. That's very important in anything. And I think that's why I think superconductors and ions right now are sticking out. They're the only platforms that can say that. So, all right, here's a picture of 5 ions, and it's embarrassingly small. We do have a template for 32, basically given by our laser and our detector. I won't get into that, but right now, because we're using old-style university-type traps, we only have 5 ions in there. And we can do something like this, a quantum Fourier transform circuit with 5 ions. This sort of takes advantage of our system in that for the QFT, you need basically all 10 pairs of ions, of qubits to interact. There are approximations that work really well. Like you could probably drop this one out and it doesn't matter so much, and that's certainly true. But if you wanted to do a square root of QFT, you'd have to have this coherent version. And we can implement this now on a PC that's connected to the system that has been calibrated. It takes an hour to calibrate, and you get a few hours of runtime, something like that. Now these gates are called, they're not controlled NOT gates, they're controlled phase gates. A controlled phase gate, there's the transformation. Basically, flip the phase of the two qubits if they're both high by an amount theta. And we can realize this by, again, with help from our computer science colleagues. We have our icing gate here, and we put rotations around it, we can realize that. So this circuit has a depth of, depth is not the right word. We have about 80 gates or so in this circuit. And it works okay. Each gate, you're dying to ask, how good are they? They're about 98%. And it's not a systematic error. It seems to be between a systematic and a random error. So we can do 80 gates with an 80% fidelity overall. Okay. Well, we have 5 ions. What a coincidence. IBM has 5 ions. So let's maybe compare the two on the same algorithm. I won't even talk about the hidden shift algorithm. It is an algorithm. Well, I will for just to define it. The hidden shift is one of these useless Oracle problems. It's an Oracle problem. It's not, you're not going to make money on the hidden shift algorithm, but it's one of those existence proofs showing that you can do something with a quantum system that you could never do classically. And that is, if I give you two functions, and they're the same function, except the inputs are shifted on one of them versus the other, the question is, what is that shift? What is that n-bit hidden shift? And classically, you have to evaluate almost all of the inputs, or half of the inputs, so 2 to the n over 2 inputs, or something like that. Quantum mechanically, you can do it in a single query by, of course, preparing superpositions. And so here's a circuit for a particular function, I won't even say it, for 4 qubits. And you can see, so in this particular circuit, the hidden shift is 1011. It's hidden. You can see it there, 1011, and there. The other part is the function itself. But this is the circuit for the hidden shift. And here's the performance of our 4-bit, the 5th bit, by the way, is an ancilla in this case. So of the 16 inputs, we prepared all 16 hidden shifts, and this is what we measured. And it was about 80% accuracy. Perfect would have been 100% on the diagonals, but you can see there are some systematic errors here. Those are actually due to measurement. And we can run the same thing on the IBM quantum experience system. And it's actually the gates on the IBM system are similar to our gates. They're about 98% plus or minus. And the measurements are very similar. It's remarkable, actually. Their gates are about 1,000 times faster. But if you're only doing 100 gates, if you're talking milliseconds or microseconds, it probably doesn't matter so much. The point is, and again, my point is not to say that ions are better than superconductors here. Everybody knows that. wait, did I say that? The point is, and this is a little unfair, because the IBM connectivity is much worse than our connectivity. But the point is, they're making a unit grid of a big 2D system. And so this is what they chose to do. And everybody knows that this is a very weak graph. And this is the strongest possible graph. We have full connectivity. And I should also be fair and say that, you know, how far can we scale this full connectivity? Not to a million, but much more than 5. And I think when IBM and other groups build their superconducting circuits, they're going to have sort of 2D nearest neighbor connectivity, which is interesting for a surface code, for instance, and I'm not addressing that. So look, the thing that I guess what really impresses me about the IBM system is they put it on the cloud. 5 qubits will be trivial no matter what. And so you could say they put it on a cloud, that's a stunt. Well, I think it's much more than that, and I think Jerry said it up here. We're probably not going to, as hardware people, find the application. It's going to happen out there, and so we need to release this stuff to the public. That's really important, and so they're owed a lot of credit for that. And let me also point out that this algorithm is not good for that connectivity, and you should think about matching your application to the system. Oh, sorry. Here's another algorithm called the Bernstein-Vazirani. Umesh Vazirani, of course, a well-known quantum computer scientist here at Berkeley. Look at that. I won't even talk about that algorithm, but look at the circuit. It's perfect for IBM, right? Look at the controlled NOT gates. They can clearly, that 5th qubit is going to be the middle one. And the results are comparable because the circuit matches the connectivity. Okay. Here's another example, something called the Toffoli gate. This is a reduced Toffoli gate. What is a Toffoli gate? It's a controlled NOT. Flip the 3rd bit if the first two are both high. This Margulis Toffoli gate is a reduced version because it has signs and phase shifts in there. The Toffoli gate turns out to be important for an adder. But you don't want those phases. So this is a reduced Toffoli gate, and it performs about the same on both systems because, look, the connectivity is fine for star versus fully connected. But the full Toffoli that doesn't have phases or signs, you can see there's a somewhat change in the performance because the information had to be moved around more in the IBM system. Okay. So Jerry said that there were 13 external papers on this, so I guess here's the 14th one. It'll appear soon. But I can't help but, I mean, it's funny, this field. And I hope it's not looked on that this is a zero-sum field, but I have to throw these referee reports. It's really funny. So when we send this to a different journal, these referees, the first one, in quantum computing, we see this a lot. When you show that 15 equals 5 times 3, it's obvious, so why bother? And the second one, maybe that's a theorist, maybe that's an experimentalist. But what Referee A said here is not highlighted, that the media and funding agencies will be interested, and we're kind of worried about that. So it's kind of interesting what's happening here. Anyway, it's just fun to poke at the overall community.
This was
Pardon me?
And yet this paper was accepted.
Not to that journal. Not naming names or anything, but it ends in L. It starts in P. Anyway, okay. So I am running out of time, but I did want to point out that one cool thing about these ions, I said they're reconfigurable. The wiring is sort of dictated by these laser beams. We can also put all laser beams on all the time. So if you do an icing gate between all pairs at the same time, you have sort of a fully connected icing model. And you can think about doing simulations of quantum magnetism and evoking adiabatic quantum computing protocols. No change in hardware, no change in controller. It's all in the software level. It's way up high in the stack. Toggle adiabatic or gate, whatever you want. You can do that here. And I do want to acknowledge my friends here at Berkeley. I would say about 10 years ago, Dan Stamper-Kern gave me a call and he said, you know, you should be thinking about doing simulations of quantum magnetism. And I replied, what's that? so that actually spawned into a big DARPA program. OLE, Wolfgang was the leader of another team. Unlike most DARPA or IARPA programs, this one was incredibly scientific. And the meetings were twice a year, but they were wonderful meetings. I just remember them all. And so Dan and his colleagues here at Berkeley, Joel and Ashvin, again, I'm not a condensed matter theorist at all, and I learned a lot from these guys and from many others in the community. So I'm going to go real quickly here. But this is some data on 14 ions. This is from a few years ago, where we have an antiferromagnetic adiabatic protocol. We're trying to find antiferromagnetic ground states. Again, the answer is obvious. It should be Niel ordered. And it is Niel ordered some of the time. Well, the most prevalent state is these two Niel ordered states. But there's also some other states that are being populated. There's dynamics going on. So these are actually becoming hard, even with just 14 spins. And again, there's a little cottage industry of using trapped ions for simulation. These are mostly from our group. There are a couple of from Rainer Blatt's group in Innsbruck starting to implement quantum magnetic models. The latest one, I'm happy to say, is a deep collaboration we've had with Norm Yao here and also Ashvin, who's in superposition on the coasts. This is the observation of time crystals that'll appear soon. It's on the archive now if you're interested. So I want to step back now and talk about why is it time to build these things. And I would say this, what I'll say here, it applies to any hardware. And we have to consider the economics of it. And this is not really physics, but if you plot the cost per qubit versus the number of qubits, you might find that many hardwares will follow some type of universal curve. Now, it costs some money to put one qubit on the table. It probably costs quite a bit more to put two because you have interactions and crosstalk. But to go from 50 to 51 is probably not a big deal. But at some point, it is a big deal, and you're running into a wall. This is going to have to do with some kind of spectral overlap, mode overlap, something. And I would argue that number is what we've been hearing all day. It's on the order of, I don't know, 25, 50, 100, whatever it is. It's going to cost a lot of money to add even a few more qubits there. And so if you plot isoclines, or whatever they are, of constant dollars, where they intersect is sort of where you're going to have a system. And I guess this would argue that we're probably going to be stuck as soon as we hit some number of dozens of qubits. And I guess my argument is that, well, that doesn't mean we're done. It just means one module has 100 qubits. We have to figure out how to reduce the connectivity and connect to another module. And I would say that any complex system, including the airline routes throughout the world, are modular. You can't fly directly from any city to any other city. It's too expensive. Probably a better analogy are multi-core processors in classical computing due to heat limitations and so forth. So we need to move information between modules. And my mentor at NIST, Dave Wineland, if he were here, he would be telling us a little bit about this picture of having a very complex ion trap where you actually physically move ions around. We thought about these ideas many years ago, and some of the chip traps are making this possible, where we can think about doing a computation in one section and then moving ions around. And again, happily, this technology is really coming along, even though this is a simple ion trap, this one here in Dave's group in Boulder, even though it hasn't quite worked so well, the idea is good, and that is having this sort of hex pattern with some 200 electrodes. You can think about switching the order of ions, moving things around. And again, Peter Mounds will talk about this on Wednesday, who accomplished ion trapper and bassoonist, I should say. And he'll tell you a little bit about the latest on doing gate operations in these chip traps. So I know I'm pretty much out of time, but I do want to say that there is another way to connect trapped ions, and that is through optical interconnects. And I think this ties into some of what Jeff Kimball talked about. Atoms are naturally optically active, so you'd be silly not to exploit the fact that you can have flying qubits and photons going back and forth. We've gone a long way on doing this probabilistically without cavities, and I know nobody wants a computer with a clock speed of 10 hertz, and as Bill Phillips tells me, it's not 10 hertz, it's 10 per second because it's asynchronous. We can make it synchronous by having a buffer and so forth through architecture, but the point is we are getting single photons from each of these ions and interfering them, destroying the photons, but when they're destroyed, they herald entanglement between these two memories. And you can go crazy and think about a large-scale architecture that uses this optical interconnect between a bunch of ion trap modules. Well, if you could only stamp out ion trap modules so that they all work really well, you could think about using existing photonic technology to scale this up. And where are we now? Yeah, embarrassingly small. I will say this 10 hertz number used to be a millihertz only 5 or 6 years ago. And to go from there to there wasn't a big deal. It was the fact that we were just collecting light a lot better. We would love to employ cavities ultimately, and there's some work in that as well. It's more research now. But I return to this picture of a modern AMO lab, and it's embarrassing. But I am happy to say that for the first time in my life, over the last year, we've been designing an experiment for almost a year. And everything you saw on that table is here. Everything. And it's less than a cubic meter. And this is through the logic program at IARPA. We're going to need to do this to get the performance necessary to realize our goals, which is to realize a logical qubit. And we have many partnerships. In particular, AO Sense will make all the CW lasers on a little cabinet. All the locking is there, everything. Coherent will make the 355 laser for us and other companies involved. Sandia will provide the chip traps that will go in that chamber. And you might argue, well, boy, that looks like a business plan. Yes, it is a business plan, because we want to connect this to a software stack and put it on the cloud eventually. And this is why IonQ is formed. And so you might know Dave Mooring. He is the CEO. Stuart Allen is a software and robotics guy who has lots of experience in development of software. Jungsang Kim at Duke is the engineering counterpart of me. And we've been working together for almost 10 years now. And so my last slide here is a quote of Bill from JQI, the Joint Quantum Institute, and he's long said that a quantum computer is to a classical computer as a classical computer is to an abacus. And the point I take from that is that not just is the model of computing different, but it looks a lot different. And there's no reason to think that a quantum computer will look anything like the hardware that's in a classical computer. So with that, thanks for your attention.
What sort of error are ion traps prone to, and how well can you correct for that error?
Mm-hmm. Okay, the errors I sort of threw on numbers around 98% or so. By the way, as the fidelities get higher, you know, measuring those errors is a research topic in its own, of course. But right now, we sort of understand that this 2% noise comes entirely from the controller. It comes from a laser beam that's flapping around in the breeze. Most experiments, as you could imagine, the laser is a few meters away from the atoms. And one thing we're counting on is by bringing it into a much smaller footprint and controlling that environment, purging it or even pumping it out to some degree will really help. So can we correct for that error? Well, these are driven errors in the gates, and I guess, you know, they're far from any interesting error correction threshold, so we don't worry about that now. But if the same type of error persists at the part per million level, then indeed we can start to think about certain codes. Now, these errors will often be correlated, though, and so, you know, I'm not going to answer your question because I think we have to wait and see what the error modes are. I guess the important point is they're not the qubit. They have nothing to do with the qubit. It's really the controller. Anytime you expose a qubit to light, then you have the errors.
I just had two questions. One was microwave-based gates, like the ones demonstrated at NIST. What's sort of the current situation with that? A few years ago, it seemed to be very promising. I haven't really heard too much about it recently.
We certainly have our eye on that. Right now, it's still researchy, in that the fidelities aren't incredibly high, and if they are high, it's with only one or two ions. The real problem is, there are ways around this, but the real problem is addressability due to the long wavelength, and also the amount of microwave power you need tends to make the ion trap really hot.
Okay.
even glowing in some cases. So there's wonderful microwave engineering, but the problem is it needs to be such high power. It's of the different sort that you have in superconductors, so I'm not slamming microwaves, I love them. We need microwave gradients is the one problem.
Yeah, that seemed to be one of the hardest things that you could.
But you know, the story may change in 5 years, I think, just due to the fact that microwaves are indeed much more mature than lasers.
I think that the second question I just had was regarding the entanglement generation rates. You said you're up to about 10 hertz and hoping to get to maybe 10 kilohertz. What's the sort of the next step to get to there?
Well, I should go through the number. Where does that 10 hertz come from? This will sound awful, but the probability, we're generating two photons, one from each ion, and the probability of getting both of them to register clicks is about 10 to the minus 5 right now. And that's about 10, it's a half a percent squared, because we have to do two things, and they're half a percent. So we're collecting 10% of the light. 20% of that makes it into a fiber. 20% of that makes a click on the detector. So the detector is only a PMT. It's not a edge superconducting detector. So that could be a factor of 4 or 5 right away. Coupling into a fiber could go from 20 to 60% if we didn't have a vacuum window in the way. Collecting 10% of light, maybe we could go to 20%. That's a little tricky. So already I've given you a factor of 2 times 4 times 5, so that's 40 squared, 1600. So look at that. I just came up with almost three orders of magnitude just by arguing. But these are all things that we know we can do this. The detector for sure. Having a nearly perfect no dark count detector, that's out there. We're just not using it now. So it's not going to be revolutionary. I think if we can integrate some of Jeff's wonderful photonic cavity circuitry on the ion trap chip, then things get even more interesting. Maybe Peter Mounds will talk a little bit about that from Sandia. This is in the long-term future to go even more than 10 kilohertz.
Okay, with that, let's thank Chris again.